troisième. Que l'es-tu qui se fait, non?
and we are honored once again to have him here today to speak to us. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Carl Anderson.
Good afternoon. So, how do you like me so far? I was asked to give a talk for a few minutes, and I will, but before I do, I have a commercial. In the year 2013, it's estimated that 63,000 Canadians died of lung cancer. The primary cause of lung cancer is smoking. I urge you students here today that are graduating, starting a new life, not to smoke. And all you adults who smoke, I urge you to quit. I say this through experience. I smoked for over 30 years, quit for over 36, put the money in the bank from my smoking, and since I quit, it's amounted to over $60,000. I said, okay, hot shot, where's the money? I spent it. I've run numerous marathons. I've run in the Arctic, I've run in the Antarctic, I've run in Greenland. All with the money I was spending on smoking. You know, I say I've run in Greenland, I've run in the Arctic, I've run in the Antarctic. I've run across glaciers, I've run up mountains. I run in New York City, and the hardest thing I ever did in my life was to quit smoking. So in order for you people that haven't started yet, the only thing I have to say is don't. Save yourself the agony of having to quit later in life. Statistics show that about 10% of the graduating class are smokers. That's not bad, because it was about 33% in 1985. The problem is, when you graduate from college, it's 21%. I guess you don't get smarter in college. I mention this because I'm not as young as I'd like to be. I feel young, don't get me wrong. But living as long as I have, I've met a lot of people who have suffered from smoking. I've seen a man who had his larynx removed and was breathing through a tube and would put the cigarette in the tube in order to get his nicotine fit. I've seen people that were 200 pounders die at 68 pounds. It's not a pleasant thing. I know you hate to start the day off with a commercial of that sort. But having said that, let's get on to better things. Half the battle is won by not smoking. It's to take care of yourself. I wish for myself and each and every one of you to die young, but as late as possible. The excuse a lot of people have for not exercising is they don't have time. If you're sick, you make time. So it is not an excuse that I take lightly. I don't think anybody has an excuse. Some people say, but my children. You're no good to the children in a sick bed. A lot of people that use other excuses, my job, my this, my that. Take care of your body and your body will take care of you. Graduating class is one thing I'd like to tell you. Whether you like it or not, you are your brother's keeper. There are a lot of things you could do for the people that are not in the position that you are. You might not have the money to help somebody, but we all have time. Go visit a sick friend. Go visit a veteran at St. Anne's Hospital. Walk for Terry Fox. Pick up money for breast cancer. Help somebody that might have muscular dystrophy or somebody with MS that might need a hand. We are our brother's keeper, whether we like it or not. So accept the fact and you'll enjoy it immensely. I'm not going to keep you here much longer, but there's one thing I'd like to say is we're not much more than 2 weeks away from Remembrance Day. Wear a poppy. Wear it proudly. And think of what these veterans have done for you. They've provided you with the freedom of religion, the freedom to vote how you want, the freedom to congregate, the freedom to do a lot of things that you wouldn't have without the veterans. A lot of them, to be exact, I say, a lot of them, there's well over 117 veterans, or soldiers, I should say, not much older than you are, who are buried in foreign fields. So think of them on Remembrance Day, wear a poppy, wear it proudly, and if you see a soldier or a veteran, thank them for what they have done for you. I have one other thing I'd like to say, and I don't want to mess it up, so I'll read it. What is a smile? It costs nothing, it creates much. It enriches those who receive it without impoverishing those who give it. It happens in a flash, and the memory of it sometimes lasts forever. There are none so rich that could get along without it, and none so poor, but are richer for its benefit. It creates happiness in the home, fosters goodwill in business, and is a countersign of friends. It is rest to the weary, daylight to the discouraged, and sunshine to the sad, and nature's best antidote for trouble. And yet it cannot be begged, bought, hoarded, or stolen, for it is something that is no earthly good to anyone until it is given away. So, if in the course of your day your friends are too tired to give you a smile, then why don't you give them one of yours? Because nobody needs a smile more than those who have none to give. Smile.
Distinguished Platform Party guests, graduates, parents, faculty, family, and friends. Before we proceed with this ceremony, I think it's fitting that I ask something of those students who are graduating here today. Graduates, I am sure that you know that the achievements which you are about to celebrate here today are not yours alone. They have not been attained independently of others in your lives. You have all had a great deal of guidance and support given to you throughout your academic journeys. That being said, I would ask all teachers to please stand and face the audience. Graduates, I would ask that you please rise and applaud your teachers in appreciation of their contributions.
Before I address the
has always been considered an important milestone in our lives. It is traditionally an official and ceremonious recognition of our achievements as young adults, ready to embark on new paths that lead to promising and exciting careers, travel, higher places of learning, and ultimately families of your own. My task here in the next 5 minutes or so is to give you my words of wisdom to you as in part about life and what I hope will be helpful to you. This is never an easy task, very much a challenging one, but here goes. What is the greatest gift, graduates, that you have ever received? Everyone, ponder that in a moment. When I first asked that question to myself, I thought about it for a while, and then I said, my first car. It was a second-hand 1973 Buick LeSabre that had a dashboard at least 2 feet deep and a gas-guzzling V8 engine. Although my dad had bought it as a family car, I was the only one in the family at that time that could drive. So by default, it really became my car. Or at least that is what I thought in my mind. We had just moved from the city to the West Island, and suddenly I could go anywhere at any time. No waiting for buses, trains, or others for a lift. What a gift it was. I would dare to venture to say that most of you here, especially you graduates, thought about a material object when I asked you about what is the greatest gift that you could receive. Perhaps a new iPhone 6, new headphones, hockey tickets, perhaps even a car. But if I told you that the gift I wanted you to identify was not a material one, but an intangible one, one that everyone is given in life, we begin to use that gift from almost the instant we are born to the time that we die. We have no control over the allotment of this gift, and yet we do control how we use it. And we do use it every day, every week, every month, every year. The gift can be used wisely, or it can be used frivolously. No other creature on earth is bestowed with this gift other than mankind. Care to guess what that gift might be? Yes, the gift is the gift of time. Who bestows this gift and why it is bestowed on us is a topic for a different discussion. But I would like to talk to you graduates about your gift of time and what you might consider doing with it. After all, your life's journey is just about to begin. Marguerite Rogoloso wrote in the Graduate School of Stanford Business Journal the following. It's a fact that most Americans are feeling more time constrained than ever, with waking hours largely consumed by work. Precious minutes remain for the daily list of to-dos, including exercise, cleaning, and socializing with friends and with family. For some, time has become even more valuable resource than money. Indeed, twice as many Americans would prefer 2 weeks of vacation over 2 weeks of extra pay. People sense that time is scarce. Decreases their willingness to give time to others, but even more so towards individuals or other worthy organizations. I mention this because I think we all agree that time is indeed precious. And as you get older, it becomes even more so, and it seems to move at a much faster rate than when we were younger. That being said, it follows that our decision about how we use time should be made carefully and with much thought and discernment. Many of you graduates will become parents one day. So I'd like you to ponder this for a moment. Will it be better to give your child a toy tiger as a gift or take them to the zoo to see a real one? Will it be better to give your child a remote control car that works right away on batteries or sit with them for hours on end helping them build their favorite Star Wars Lego ship or a model of the Titanic that has 1,367 pieces? Will it be better to spend the long hours at your desk at work or be home for supper and then rush off to hockey or scouts with them? The answer is provided for me every time I hear a child say, "My dad took me to the zoo and we saw a real tiger." Or, "Look at what I helped my dad build." Or, "My mom always takes me to hockey practice and she doesn't even like it." As future parents, the time you will spend with your children will truly be a gift for you both. Our gift of time can also be spent in many other rewarding and crucial ways, and that list could go on for pages. But I would suggest that you consider the following as you go on with your lives. Give time to your friends when they are in need. Give time to a stranger when they are in need. Give time to family members when they are in need. Remember that time is truly the greatest gift that you can give. Again, I ask you to consider, what is better when a friend asks you for a favor? Do you ask what the favor is, or do you simply say, "Sure, what do you need me to do?" There's a big difference. If a homeless person asks you on the street for change, you simply give them a tune or take the time to buy him a coffee and a muffin. How will your uncle feel who recently lost his wife when you call and say, "Uncle Tony, let's do lunch tomorrow"? A last thought about time. Take time for yourselves. Take time to take a walk on the mountain. Take time to play your favorite sport. Take time to read the book and not just see the movie. You deserve a bit of time as well. So the challenges remain, and it is one that I leave you with: finding the time. Finding the balance in life where you can use and cherish the most precious gift that has been given to us. Easy? Not in the least. And I, for one, have struggled with it all my life. In the end, it is a struggle that certainly has its rewarding moments when the right choice is made. Malcolm Bain once said, "If you wait until you can do everything for everybody instead of something for somebody, you'll end up not doing anything for anybody." In closing, I will quote a very good friend who once said, "Ultimately, we are never judged on what we do, but rather what we leave undone." What have you left undone today? What will you leave undone tomorrow and the day after that? I dare say that if you see the globe as forever shrinking, and that we must all do our share in preserving it and making it a better place for all, then you will have no regret about having left something undone. And my final thoughts: whatever you do, do it with integrity. Do it with conviction in what you believe is right. Do it with passion. Do it for the benefits of others. And finally, do it with humility. Thank you.
I'd like to invite a smoking to the stage.
Stage. Forgiving Foundation. I remember the day when I told her that
Mr. Andrew Meads to present the award to River McLaughlin. Jessica, Angelo, Katerina.
Chris, Agnes, Warren, Savannah, Michael, Kiernan, and Tyler. Let's go. the Bronze Medal of the Governor General of Canada. This is awarded to the student who graduates with the highest standing in the graduating class. Ms. Sophie Frankel, would you please do the honor to Ms. Nura Berger.
Thank you. accolade, distinction, immersion, and absentia.
Sabrina Kalati. calling.
Ms. Beth Kiesman to present the students with their diplomas and awards, and Ms. Roxana Perez to present the gift. LGS Distinction. Mr. Keyshawn Eversley Morrell, Distinction. Ms. Hannon Falah, AP. Mr. Joshua Fontaine. Mr. Evangelos Frangos. Ms. Sarah Friedman. Gazi Joyet. Mr. Casey Gilbert Chan. Miss Harmony Jubilee Westcott. Mr. Scott Glassman. Distinction. Ms. Jessica Gomez Huddy. Distinction. Mr. Rami Graham Pakang, distinction. Mr. Ross Green, distinction and AP. Mr. James Giacom, honor roll and AP. Ms. Dana Hykalis, honorable.
Ms. Selena Hykalis, honorable AP and bilingual certificate.
I'm Mr. Damien Kasuri, Distinction AB. Mr. Donovan Lopat-Mahar. Devin Coltide. Ms. Jada Anissa LaVon. Mr. James Langshaw. Ms. Destiny Lavelle. Ms. Yuji Lee. Mr. Gopal Lagaratnam, Miss Kayla Marie McDonald. Ms. Katarina Mazzarini. Ms. Lee Mallon, honor roll. Mr. Leo Barcil, Distinction, AP Immersion. Mr. Daniel Marriott. Mr. River Lachlan. Ms. Erin McRae. Ms. Esme Miller, AP. Ms. Luna Billy Lovett, all AP Immersion and Absentia. Mr. Marcus Mitchell, Distinction. Mr. Richard Morales Silva, distinction. In absentia.
Like that.